Hi, you're watching Beyond the Headlines and I'm Nikita Arora. Now, some news stories are complex. They need more research, more patience and more time. But our lives get busy and we often find ourselves in the middle of these stories. It's like the saying Inception about dreams. You never remember how it all began. So on this show, we pick a story, evaluate its complexities, understand its nuances and probe. We probe beyond the headlines. Today, we're going to be talking about the opioid crisis. Now, this is a global issue, but America is at the epicenter of this crisis, with 80% of the global opioid pills being consumed here, even though it's home to less than 5% of the world's population. 116 people are dying in America every single day in opioid-related incidents. Now, last year, the American government announced this as a public health emergency. And this year, on the 19th of March, President Trump declared a plan to deal with the epidemic. So what are opioids? Opioids are a class of drugs. So they include the illicit drug heroin, but they also include prescription painkillers like morphine, fentanyl, oxycodone and so on. Now for the purpose of this video, we'll focus on prescription painkillers because as opposed to recreational drugs, they are available to patients officially and legally. And they behave with our brain in the same way as opium does. So they react with the opioid receptors in our brain to relieve pain, but they also produce euphoria. And that leads to addiction, withdrawal, dependence, overdose, and even death. In fact, according to the Center for Disease Control, most people who use heroin today have had a history of using prescription opioids in the past. That's why they're called gateway drugs. And if you actually go to see, prescription opioids entered the American market sometime in the early 1970s. And at that time, doctors were still apprehensive about prescribing these to patients because of their addictive qualities. But today, that's no longer true. In 2016, there were a total of 63,632 total drug overdose deaths, out of which 66%, which is 42,249 deaths, occurred as a result of opioid overdoses. And if you actually compare the use of illicit drugs like heroin and cocaine with the misuse of prescription painkillers, 27 out of 1,000 people use illicit drugs, but 47 out of 1,000 people misuse prescription painkillers. So how did it all come to this? It all began with one letter in 1980. In 1980, the Boston University Medical Center published a five-line letter in the New England Journal of Medicine, a prestigious journal, that said, "Despite widespread use of narcotic drugs in hospitals, the development of addiction is rare in patients with no history of addiction." Now, this was used as evidence by doctors, academics, and pharmaceutical companies to justify liberal opioid prescriptions. But that was a complete misrepresentation, because the research was specific to certain circumstances. The research was conducted on hospitalized patients who were under medical supervision, not on people who are prescribed take-home painkillers for minor injuries. As a result of that, by 2016, doctors were writing almost 66 prescriptions for every 100 Americans, and pharmacies had dispensed about 215 million opioids. Other than this, The Guardian reported of massive lobbying by US pharma giants. According to the US Senate committee, they said, the five biggest companies that produce prescription opioids have spent about $10 million since 2012 on patient advocacy and medical groups to encourage the use of addictive drugs. Yesterday, that's on the 23rd of March, President Trump and the American government announced that they were going to sue certain drug companies over this crisis. What made the situation worse was the emergence of pill mills. These are unregulated pain relief centers that basically dispense opioids to anybody who shows up with a pain complaint. Opioid overdose is a complex problem. Doctors overprescribe opioids so that patients don't have to visit them often. This leaves patients with large quantities of opioids that they continue to take even after the pain has been relieved. Sometimes they're passed on to friends and family to treat minor pains and injuries without any medical consultation. Sometimes they fall into the hands of children who inadvertently get addicted or risk an overdose. With increased tolerance, people are also inclined to take more opioids than prescribed. And lastly, and perhaps most importantly, opioids don't improve body function. They only relieve the pain, they don't treat the ailment. That leads to a long-term dependence on the drugs. On 19th March, President Trump announced a series of steps to combat the opioid epidemic. He declared increased federal funding for non-addictive painkillers, more awareness commercials, stricter implementation of best practices, and tougher action on drug dealers. Perhaps the most controversial was that he suggested the death penalty for drug dealers in some cases. In fact, Attorney General Jeff Sessions has already sent a memo to prosecutors asking them to pursue capital punishment in cases involving large quantities of drugs. So while most of these measures are potentially constructive, drug policy experts do have reservations about tougher punitive measures, particularly the death penalty. They think what America needs is more proactive approaches, like better access to antidotes, more controlled painkiller prescriptions, alternative treatments like physiotherapy, and mental health counseling. So while America is reeling in its worst health crisis, with hundreds of thousands of people attempting to shake off the addiction, what it needs is an approach that is more victim-centric and less culprit-centric.